Okay, 13.3, base E. E is a variable that represents a number, much like pi. When we see the value pi, the symbol, we automatically think of the number 3.14. So when we see the value or the variable E, we need to think 2.718. These are both non-ending, non-repeating numbers. E is just a representation of a number. So when we're finding f of x equals e to the x, you punch these into your calculator. Nobody expects you to raise 2.718 to a power. Okay? But this is an exponential because the variable is in the exponent. So I created this little table of values, which gave me this graph. The graph is important because it gives us the parent function of e to the x. And we're going to make the shifts in the translations just like we've been doing with every other function. So it goes along. The function is increasing because as we go bigger on the x, the y gets bigger. Here, g of x equals a times e to the x minus h plus k. Very familiar, very similar to what we've been doing with all our functions. A stretches the graph vertically. H translates the graph horizontally. K translates the graph vertically. The values of A, H, and K are not changing. We do not have B in this case. Domain, the X values are all reals. It goes left to right. Your range, because we have an asymptote here at Y equals 0, our range is greater than 0. It doesn't go below. Our reference points that we'll use for our translations are 0, 1, and 1, comma, E. The asymptote is Y equals K. So whatever our k value is. So what we're going to do is we're going to practice graphing a few, and then we're going to practice looking at a couple graphs and being able to write the equation. So getting started, we're going to slide the board down just a little, and we're going to look at our first problem. So it says, given a function, use the reference points and translations to graph. State the transformations, the asymptote, domain, and range. So it doesn't necessarily matter whether you see the translations first or after with using it with the graph. So what we want to do is look at our equation. What's happening? What is the 3 doing? Well, we want to write it out. The 3 means it's being stretched vertically by a factor of 3. This 1 up here, remember, it's always x minus h, so it's the opposite. So this means that this is moving actually to the left. So it's translating horizontally left 1 unit. And then the 4, our k value, is translating vertically up 4 units. The asymptote, y equals k. Our k value is 4, so that means our asymptote is y equals 4. Domain is going to be all reals, and since there's no negative here, that means our range is going to be greater than 4. So our domain, x, such that x is an element of the reals, goes from negative infinity positive infinity, written in interval notation would be negative infinity comma positive infinity. The range, y, such that y is an element of the reals, y is greater than 4. So our bottom value is 4 and it goes to positive infinity. So I filled in this part of it. Now I need to use my reference points to be able to graph this appropriately. So my reference points, remember, were 0, 1, and 1, comma, e. So I'm going to slide my board just over a little and make a little bit of space over here to talk about what my translations will do to my reference points. So 0, 1, and then we have the point 1, comma, e. Remember, e is just a value. You plug it into your calculator. I'm not so sure you guys can see that, so let's see. If I do it in black, maybe it'll show up a little better. Okay. Now, We need to look at this. We're stretching vertical by a factor of 3. That means that the y value is getting multiplied by 3. Translating horizontally left one unit, that means we're going to subtract 1 from the x value. Translating vertically up 4, that means after I multiply by the 3, I'm going to add the 4. So when we look at our new points, 0 minus 1 is negative 1. That's 3 plus 4 is 7. Here, 1 minus 1 is 0. And then I say 3 times e plus 4. Don't know what that is. So the way you figure out what it is you plug it into your calculator. There is an E button, and you should get the decimal approximate for graphing purposes to be 12.154, I believe. Remember, E is about 2.718. So we plug it in, we get that value. Now, we're going to graph those values. So at negative 1, I'm up at 7. And at 1, I'm at 12.1, it's a decimal, and it's going to be an approximate, so right there. Remember, we need to get our asymptote in. Our asymptote is at y equals 4. So there is that equation, y equals 4. And remember, it's an uphill, so it's going to go in an upward motion, and it's going to go through our values. So it's going to get really close, it's going to climb up, and there we go. We have our graph. So let's try another one. This one that we're going to try next has a negative in there. So we want to look at the different ways the negative can change our equation. So I know that the asymptote is my k value. So that's y equals negative 1. I know I have an asymptote right there at negative 1. Domain and range. I know that my domain is going to be all real, so I'm going to go ahead and write that in. And I know it's going to go from negative infinity to positive infinity. Now, I'm a little unsure of my range. I believe that negative, it's going to flip it over the x-axis. So I'm going to think it's below my x-axis. And we'll go back and check it when we're done. So y is going to be down here, so it's going to be less than negative 1. So that means we're going to go from negative infinity to negative 1 will be my interval. Let's talk about our translations. We have 4 things happening. That negative flips it over the x-axis. So it's going to be reflected, using our academic vocabulary, over the x-axis. The point 0.5 means that it is stretched vertically by a factor of 0.5. And then h, because it's a minus, means it's translated horizontally. Translated horizontally right 2 units. And that negative 1 means that it's translated vertically down 1 unit. All right, so we've written in all the stuff we can write in. Now we actually need to graph it, which means we need to look at the translation of the points. So I'm going to erase the prior problem over here. Give me some space to look at our reference points, 0, 1, and 1, comma, e. And let's look at what we're going to do to those values. So in this case, that negative 0.5, that's a stretch. It's actually not a stretch. It's going to be a compression because it's a fraction. And we're going to multiply it by that. And then that negative 2 means I'm going to add 2 to the x, because remember it's the opposite, and subtract 1 from the y. So my new values become 2, that's negative 0.5 minus 1, that's negative 1.5. Here, 1 plus 2 is 3, And then when I multiply e times negative 0.5 and subtract 1, I get the value of negative 2.359 about. It's an approximate. So we're going to graph our new points. We have a positive 2, negative 1.5 here. We have at 3, we're at negative 2.359. So it looks like our graph is moving down and arching this way. So we go, boom. And there we go. We have our graph. This is a sketch because we didn't graph every point on the curve. All right, so next we're going to look at some equations where we look at the graph and we actually write the equation from the graph. So I have two problems over here. We're going to start with this one. We're going to write the equation of the graph, and then we're going to state the domain and the range. So here's our picture. We have this function. It goes through the point 4, 6. It's increasing. We have an asymptote here at 4. So if the asymptote's at 4, that means our k value is 4. We have the point 0, 1 gets translated to 4, 6. Well, that means that the h value was added to x, so h is the 4. So we're going to look at this equation, and we're going to start plugging numbers in. I know my h value is 4, so I'm going to plug in the 4 here. I know my k value is also 4, so I'm going to plug that in. And then I need to figure out what a is. So to do that, I'm going to plug in a value for g of x, and I'm going to plug in the value for g of x, and I'm going to plug in the value for the x. The other point they give you has an e in it. I wouldn't use that point. I would actually go back and use this for your x and your g of x. So that means g of x is going to be 6, and your x value is going to be 4. Remember, e is a number. So subtract the 4 both sides. We get 2 equals a times e to the 0. Anything to the 0 power is 1. So that's 2 equals a times 1. So a is really just 2. Now writing our equation, g of x equals 2 times e to the x minus 4 plus 4. This is our equation for that function. Now we're going to look at another one. Practice one more time. So we have this function here. The asymptote is here at negative 6. That means your k value is negative 6. We have the point negative 4, 8. So going from 0 to negative 4 means h must be a negative 4. So we're going to plug values in. So for k, I have not a plus, but a minus 6. And for my h, that double negative means that becomes a positive 4. And I'm going to use this point, negative 4, negative 8, for x and g of x. The other value has e in it. I wouldn't use it. It's going to be a decimal and pretty ugly. So this gets negative 8, and my x value gets a negative 4. The other nice thing is when you use this, this becomes 0, and e to the 0 is just 1. So I'm going to add 6 to both sides. So I get negative 2 equals a times e to the 0. E to the 0 is 1. So a is negative 2. And when I go to write my equation, g of x equals negative 2 e to the x plus 4, and then it's a minus 6. Now, it asks me to also state domain and range. So going back to this first one over here, my domain is all reals. That's always going to be the case with your e values. So negative infinity to positive infinity. But the range, it's above 4. So that means that your range, it's an element of the reals, but y is greater than, not 0, but 4. Now, we have our interval goes from positive 4 to positive infinity. So our domain for our second one, again, is all reals. So we have negative infinity to positive infinity. Interval notation as well. Then your range. It's not above it, it's below, and it's below the negative 6. So y is an element of the reals, but y is less than negative 6. So our interval goes from negative infinity to negative 6, and we're good to go.